Good evening, everybody, and welcome to Las Vegas, and welcome to VegasAllNetRadio.com. 7 o'clock Thursday night, which means it's time to unwrap Vegas, which means it is time for Vegas Unwrapped. Right here live from Studio 1A, welcome the host of the show, Mr. Aaron Phillips, Ricky the Cash Man back at the Cash Compound somewhere, and of course, John J-Peg Styles, and yours truly, the Bobcat. Good evening, gentlemen.
Good evening, Mr. Bobcat. Thank you very much for that introduction. Welcome to Vegas Unwrapped, coming to you live from beautiful downtown Las Vegas at the VNR Studios. Coming to you with our first show of the month of November.
Already.
Man, yeah. Oh man, where's the time going?
I don't know. We've survived another month and almost another week.
We are where I'm just happy to survive each day as it comes, Mr. JPEG.
One heartbeat at a time.
You betcha. Welcome. We have a packed show tonight. Don't know if Mr. Cash is calling in or not from the compound. I tried calling him an hour ago. No answer on his cell phone. Actually, I haven't spoken to the devil the last couple of days, so I don't know what's happening there.
I think he's probably in a deep depression because of his
Mets.
Didn't quite make it.
No, so. Well, I mean, they made it. They just didn't win.
They didn't go all the way.
No, they did not. But you know what? They are playing with house money this year because no one expected them to get to the World Series this year anyway. So it was just kind of one of those things that they expected them there next year, maybe the year after. But it was a good experience, good for the Mets.
Practice, right?
So, yeah, exactly. You know what? I mean, listen, Kansas City got there last year. They lost to the Giants last year, and here they came back this year. And you know what? They won it all, and Kansas City was a great team. But I have to admit, I did not have to make any calls to talk them off the ledge.
Good.
The other night.
Because
he couldn't get up there anyway.
He couldn't get up
there
anyway.
No, he wouldn't get up there anyway. I'd have to talk him off maybe a step.
Yeah,
that would be a bad
hit. He's going to jump off the front stoop.
Exactly. But I will say this, though. I saw him over the weekend. On Saturday, I believe, we were over at his compound, and he looked great. He's walking around outside more and more,
good.
So he's getting mobile. And according to his plan, he'd like to be back here in the office on some sort of schedule. If not the week of Thanksgiving, maybe a little bit the week before. So, you know, hopefully we can get him back here because we miss him here and everybody asks for him and I'm tired of answering for him. So hopefully he'll get back here.
He needs to get his ass back to work. So
he
needs to do.
I know.
I mean, we've been carrying this guy for weeks now, haven't we?
I know. That's saying it politely. 702-483-4444 is our number. Tonight's show, we're going to be kicking off a regular monthly segment.
Yeah.
Is that right there, Mr. Styles?
That's right.
And
we found a couple of suckers.
Yes, we did.
To come in here.
Yes, we did.
Once a month, boy.
To fill the
know.
Air. I don't know what you.
And you know they've been here already, so I can't even believe that
they chose to come back. I know. I don't know what you offered them to do it, but they're back. Joining us after our first break, Steve and Sue Onorato, pet rescuers extraordinaire, are here back in the studio to share some more insights and updates and more things going on in the rescue world.
And some exciting news, too.
I know, exciting news. So we got some good stuff going on there. And in our second hour, we have Stacey Rinieri, who owns Ranieri, and I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly, Ranieri Construction. She recently, the company's been in town since 74, so they've been here, you know, for a long time. But Stacey was actually featured on one of these home construction shows on the HGTV, the Home and Garden TV network, last month.
Cool.
And I wanted to, you know, I thought it would be great to introduce her to the market and to our audience and find out more about that and about the company. So Stacey will be joining us in the second hour. I've been promised that Doing It With Styles is a really good one this week.
I think you'll like it.
All right. So we have that coming up. Unwrapped Treasures as we head into November. We'll do that at the top of the hour. I do have celebrity birthdays and dates in history, just in case we decide to throw that in somewhere. And, of course, we'll wrap up with weird news at the end, letting everybody know that we're okay in comparison to some of these nut jobs around the world.
Yeah, sometimes I wonder.
You know, I pre-read these stories, and as I read them, I just have to shake my head wondering, what the hell are these people thinking? All right, with that, any shout-outs, any particular?
Yes, as a matter of fact, I do have.
Excellent.
Thank you for asking.
There you go.
All right, here's my shout-outs for tonight. I'd like to give a shout-out and a hello to Tracy, Neil, Joe, Rhonda, Sean, Dane Biren, Brooke Engine, Regina, and Alan Childs.
Regina. You sure?
Absolutely.
Okay, not Regina.
Nope, not Regina.
Not vagina.
Nope.
I mean, I might as well say it. Everybody's singing of it. So
he's been off seeing Rock of Ages.
I know. Yeah,
that's where he's been.
It rhymes with pussy.
Oh, yes. Okay. There we go. And it's only six minutes after the hour.
Regina is a character in the Rock of Ages show.
Gotcha.
That I have fallen in love with because the actress that plays that, Brooke, has nailed that character. I knew that character.
Okay.
And the only difference is the one I knew was just a little bit taller, and her name was Linda.
I see.
But, you know, pot-smoking, vegan activist.
Uh-huh. I smell another ex-wife coming along here.
So anyway, but she nailed it. She just got this, and I'm going to have to give her an award one of these nights because I just was... Just really a standout performance.
All right. Now, I've heard commercials on TV that Rock of Ages is looking to move in a couple of months. Is that right?
There are rumors.
I mean, that's what I'm saying. No, I'm saying. I mean,
right. There are some rumors.
They're scuttlebutt, right?
Right.
So
I got the official dirt on this.
Nah, let's leave it
don't.
A scuttlebutt.
Yes, I do.
Let's leave it a scuttlebutt.
No, you don't.
Maybe Alan will talk about it on his show later on tonight, coming up with Psychedelic Circus. But, you know, until we hear it from the horse's mouth, you never know what goes on in this town anyway. So any other shout-outs? Anybody else you want to recognize?
Yeah, but they know who they are.
All right, there you go. A couple of things from the news that I – first of all, a couple of things from the news I want to touch on.
Please do. Oh, no, don't.
Why?
Go ahead.
All right, well, first of all, before I get into news, you know, I was listening to Corey's show before us, Corey Taylor Talks.
Yes.
She's 16.
Yes.
Right?
And she's almost normal.
She's about the normalest one of the crazy group here.
You know, she had Veronica Beauchamp, who we had on our show here a couple of weeks ago. And in talking with Veronica, we learned that she was a victim of bullying.
Yes.
And I did not know this until I listened to the end of Corey's show, because towards the end, they were talking about her experience.
Right.
I didn't know Corey was also bullied.
Oh.
Yes.
Yes.
I did not know that. So here's, you know, this is a little bit of an editorial. Okay. Here we have two...
It's your show.
It's our show.
It's our show.
All right. Here's two 16-year-old gals. Okay. And not your normal ones.
Exactly.
And I say that positively. I don't mean to be negative. Here you got Corey, who is on the radio, who's got probably the number one, number two show here in our network show. He's flip-flops with Vegas Rock Dog on Saturdays, who's in movies, who's an actress, who's just doing things and leaps and bounds. I mean, all over the red carpets, interviews. I mean, you name it, she gets them on her show.
Yep.
You got a 16-year-old gal who is a queen in her pageant circuit that she's got some nationals coming up later this month. I don't know where this gal finds time to sleep. She got an internship with
Joe Heck.
Joe Heck. She's a student at Green Valley High School. Mm-hmm. She's in Girl Scouts.
Yep.
She does Project for Everybody Under the Sun, Wounded Warriors, Pets. I mean, you name it. How she finds time, I mean, there's only 168 hours in a week. I think she works...
Not in her week.
Well, not... I was going to say...
I think she gets more hours in her week.
I was going to say, I think her week is about 300 hours.
Yeah, it has to be.
I really don't know where she studies. She goes to school and everything else. I was so saddened to hear... I didn't know Corey was also a victim of bullying. It's so depressing to hear. Here are two fabulous young gals who are 16 years old, who are doing things that most people dream of doing in their lifetime. I mean, I've done community service for 25 years, so I get what Veronica's going through. At the age of 16, I was not thinking about being on the radio like Corey. I was playing football in high school. I was worried. I was just, you know, living. I didn't think about the stuff. What is going on? It is such a sad state of affairs. And then I read today that 8-year-old boy who was shot.
Yes.
That ruled to be a suicide.
Yeah.
And I haven't read the whole story. I just saw the title the title online. What the hell's going on?
That story brought Miss Bobcat to tears.
What was the basis behind that?
I really don't know. I jumped out of the shower and was getting ready to come to work, and she was sitting there finishing up some stuff for you guys on the Vegas Unwrapped page.
Right.
And I looked down, and she's in tears, and I said, "What's going on?" I didn't know if she was sick or something was wrong. And she said, "Did you read about this little boy?" And I said, "No." They thought, well, something at first, they didn't know if it was a stray gunshot. They didn't know if something happened with a family member and what all. She says, but it's been determined this little boy killed himself with an unprotected gun. And, you know, come on, folks. I'm all for the right to bear arms, but come on. You've got to have safety devices and things. It's just, I didn't catch the whole story, and I got here, and I've been so busy, but this is just a tragedy all the way around.
And then that police officer in, what was it, Illinois or Ohio? Yeah. Who were at first it looked like he was killed by a gunman, then it comes out that was ruled a suicide.
Well, and that's a little bit of a different story, because it turns out that he and his family were kind of involved in some criminal activities.
Oh, okay. So there was more detail, but still.
There's more to it than that.
In that scenario, committing suicide is the chicken shit way out, quite frankly.
Yeah.
And I say that with all due respect to those who have suffered from suicide. But reading, you got these marches in London, the 100,000 mask guys, that was all of a sudden they're burning cars. And yet in Kansas City yesterday, 800,000 people got together to celebrate the Royals.
The Royals.
Did you see the pictures?
Yes, I did.
You saw nothing but blue in that downtown area, in the park area. 800. Now, I haven't read if there were any incidents or, God forbid, someone got hurt or whatever, but still. 800,000 people, and for all intents and purposes, it was a safe event.
Yes, it was.
I
it was relatively uneventful. No, nothing that I read.
Nothing crazy.
The Royals were about 20 minutes late getting there, and that was just due to the traffic jam.
Due to traffic to try to get, because they had a parade.
Right.
Yeah, and nobody turned over any cars.
No.
No.
And actually, the city was really cool, because we used to live there.
Right.
And so they took the 670 bypass, which sort of swings you through the loop of the downtown area.
Okay.
And the cops just stopped the traffic and let people park their cars, because they had to walk about a mile and a quarter to get to where the actual parade route or into the route. But they didn't write no tickets. They didn't bring the tow trucks. They left everybody alone. And they said probably the biggest day off of work ever in Kansas City, Missouri history.
Yeah.
And Aaron said 800-some-odd thousand people there. So it was a great thing for that town, great thing for the Kansas City Royals organization, because they've been struggling through the years. Yeah. I mean, they really have. But so...
That's it's proof that it can be done.
Sure. Absolutely.
You know,
Just got a text. Angela Savage from Good News with Angela Savage, Monday mornings here at 10 o'clock, is listening to us as well. So I give her a shout out.
Boy, she must be really bored.
I'm telling you. It's, you know, well, she lives in Boulder City.
Hey, I mean, you know, Angela, just to give you a heads up, you left your jacket and your shirt here in the studio last week. It's hanging up in my office.
She left here with no clothes on.
I don't know. As much as hanging on the wall, it sort of makes me wonder.
I'm telling you.
Angela, you naughty girl.
He doesn't just have it hanging. It's framed. I saw it. Okay, couple
other... what can I say? Doing it with styles. A
couple other pieces of news I just want to throw out there. George Barris. You know who George Barris is? Did I just blow your Doing It With Styles award? Well, that's twice I've done that to you.
Yeah, I know.
I had to bring it up because he designed my all-time favorite car, the Batmobile.
Yeah,
and as
exactly.
a Batman nut, he also did the Munster Mobile and many others, and he passed away today.
And you know what was bitching? he's from Southern California.
Right.
And I used to live not far from the place where he built all these cars.
Oh, really?
And going down there and you know, in high school and seeing all of these cars for real. I mean, it was just you have no idea, man. I mean, you see them in the movies and all that,
right?
But to see the actual cars is just
There was one time there was a car collector down in the Southwest off of like Valley View and we'll say Post Road for the sake of just getting the general area. And my wife and I and my kids, we went down there one day because they had the Batmobile there. Okay, and I'm like, this to me is the Holy Grail. Okay. So, and they had the Green Hornet car there and they had many of the other cars there. So they had the Batmobile set up in this fake cave, this cave-like looking design. So I'm tiptoeing, and I'm tiptoeing to it. And you can see on the floor, you know, there's the orange line. Right. Don't step over here. I'm like, yeah.
Or you'll be shot.
Oh, yeah. Okay. I'm not going to step on that line. You're full of shit. I'm not going to step on that line. So I was just in awe. I was just in awe of just looking at the car. I saddled up to the side of the car. No alarms went off. I looked in. I even touched the telephone in the car. I touched the steering wheel in the car. I was just googly what looking at the car. So, I mean, the guy was a master in redesigning and designing.
Oh, he was brilliant.
Vehicles.
Just brilliant. I mean, he has done so many cars that and nothing, you know, not that all of them were famous.
No.
Just to go see what this guy was thinking. I mean,
absolutely.
Just
to go from concept to final product is amazing.
Yeah.
Two other pieces of note: NHL expansion. They thought that the NHL governing body was going to vote on the expansion team at the expansion teams December 7th and 8th in the next governor's meeting. Of course, Vegas and Quebec are the two finalists, but it looks like that's going to be postponed until January to the next governor's meeting before the All-Star game. So everybody's got to be patient, and there's a ton of people who spent lots of money in those pre-sale tickets. And then lastly, I just wanted to share that if you go to the Vegas Unwrapped fan page on Facebook, there are now 41 stores that are officially listed as being closed for Thanksgiving. And it seems to me that list every year will obviously continue to grow. And I'll just share a couple of them out there that I know are here in town. Bed Bath & Beyond, Costco, Crate & Barrel, Dillard's, Guitar Center is going to be closed, Harbor Freight, Hobby Lobby is going to be closed, Home Depot, IKEA is on the list, but they're not open here yet to be closed, so they're closed. Nordstrom's, Petco, PetSmart, Sam's Club, TJ Maxx, and many others. So you just go to our Facebook page, check out the list that's there right now. 41 stores and counting that will not be open for Thanksgiving. So if your favorite store is on that list, enjoy Thanksgiving. So with that, Mr. Bobcat, I think I'm running a few minutes late for our first break, so why don't you take it away?
That's all right. Well, hey, I got a little message for you. I know you're a big Batman and Batmobile.
Absolutely.
You know Michael Goddard, the guy that does the artwork with the martinis here in Las Vegas?
Oh, yeah.
He's got Batmobile number 4.
Really?
And it's up for sale.
Oh, sure. Let me write a check right now.
I'll send him a
message.
Probably
bounce anyway.
I'll send him a message.
We could trade the station.
Yeah, exactly.
Now, that would probably be about 4 stations, okay? There you go.
Jeez.
All righty. Our first guests are sitting by, and they're ready to go. You're locked and loaded on a Thursday night with Vegas Unwrapped. Aaron Phillips, Missing the Cash Man, back at the compound. John J. Pig Styles, yours truly, the Bobcat here. More with us. We take this quick break.
All right, welcome back to Vegas Unwrapped. Again, we appreciate you listening in. 702-483-4444
is
our number.
Yeah, not 4440.
No, not 4440 like was erroneously put out by somebody.
Sorry.
4444.
That's okay. He'll learn.
He'll learn this thing.
It
took us all this time.
The number's right in front
of me. Well, it's right in front of me, so I know what it is.
I know. That's why I always look at it. It's crazy. All right, joining us now at the microphone, Stu. I see I just combined them. Stu and Eve. Steve Onorato.
There's Stu and Eve.
Jeez Louise. What's going on? I better go get my inhaler. Anyway, because I got some good stuff in there. Welcome back, guys. Pet Rescuers Extraordinaire. What's cooking? All right, don't all jump out at once now.
One of you has to talk now.
Yeah, that's right. Dead air is bad for radio.
She starts off. Let her start off.
We're
going to
do that again.
That's right.
Hi, Sue. What's going on?
How are you?
So what's happening in the world?
Couple little things. Let's see. We're going to start off. We're talking a lot about Poppy this time.
Poppy
Foundation.
Poppy, yes.
Yes. Yes. We didn't get a lot of information.
No, we didn't get a whole lot of time last time.
No. So we're going to start with them.
Okay.
I wanted to tell you about one of the rescues that I did with them.
All right.
And actually, this rescue started here in Vegas.
Really?
Yes. It was a little Cornish Rex girl, a little cat.
With no hair.
Yes.
Okay.
Not a single hair, yes. And big eyes, big ears. If you Google the Cornish Rex, you'll see what kind of cat that is. And it's a beautiful little cat. Doesn't look like it belongs in the desert, though, because it has no hair and very light skin. Well, somehow this little girl ended up here in Vegas wandering around somebody's yard. And they said, well, that's not my cat, but it doesn't look like it belongs outside. So they brought it into Bonanza Cat Hospital. They scanned it for a chip, and lo and behold, it was chipped, and the owner was listed as in Nebraska.
Wow.
A woman in Nebraska.
Now, yes. how does an animal go from Nebraska to Vegas?
Well, that's not even
the worst. If you listen, you'll find out.
Yeah, that's not even
that's
the worst.
That's not even that's
wow. Yeah. I mean, I have a yeah. picture, and right. surprisingly, the cat mm-hmm. looks like Ricky Cash, but I don't know. You know, I don't know.
You know, you're right. No, I didn't notice that
no
before.
No hair, so you know, the ears sticking
yep,
out.
That's it.
Is he a skin seal?
Yeah, exactly.
Sorry, Sue.
That's
please
quite
continue.
All right. Actually, the chip was registered to a woman in Nebraska, so they okay. called her and said, I think we have one of your cats here. And she said, I don't think that's possible. My cats are gone. They unfortunately died many years ago.
Wow.
And turns out the story was that this woman and her husband, I think it was a military family, stationed in Japan. I believe they divorced in Japan.
Wow.
And it was a nasty divorce, so he took her cats. There was male and female.
Right.
And whatever he did with them, but told her that they had died.
Wow.
So this was like 8 years ago that all this happened. They left Japan. He went his way. She went hers. She ended up in Nebraska. I don't even know where the guy is. I don't know if he came here with the cats
right.
or gave them to somebody else and they came here with the cats. The woman herself has never been to Vegas. So
really, at this point, who cares where the guy is?
Yeah, well, really.
Yeah. So, but basically, the cat made it from Japan somehow to here in Vegas.
Exactly. Right? And we don't know that part, and we don't know if the male also made it here, because the person
sure.
here only found the female so
wow.
far. So again, we called the woman, and she was just beside herself. She was like, are you sure? And they were like, absolutely. They sent a picture.
Right.
And it was very heartwarming to her to know that her cat
and,
is still
and
here.
And how old was the cat, roughly?
Like 8?
Yeah, because she was just a kitten when they
wow.
were in
probably
Japan.
Even older
so,
than that.
Yeah, about 8 or 9 years old at this point.
That's amazing. Now, this is going to sound like a silly question because I truly don't know the answer to this.
Mm-hmm.
We say the cat's 8 years old. Mm-hmm. Dog years, it's 7 to 1. What's the ratio with cats? Is
you know,
there a ratio?
It's less.
It's less, but it's not as clear cut because as the cat ages, the years get
less.
Yeah,
so it's like a
less.
Prorated age?
Exactly.
Well, don't we wish we all had that?
Last I heard was like 4 to 5.
Mm-hmm.
Comparatively.
4 or 5 to 1.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay,
so
just curious.
But this is, go ahead, I'm sorry.
That's okay. So what we did is when this woman confirmed, yes, that's my cat, and I still can't believe she's there, but I have children in school and everything, and I don't know how I would ever get her. So Linda Newman at the Poppy Foundation said, well, you know, maybe we can find somebody who will transport. She threw it out to the board, which we are board members, and
right.
I was like, I'll go.
Yeah. Hello.
I'll go. And the woman flat out said, I will pay all the transportation costs.
Wow.
If anybody can bring her home,
wow.
I'll pay for it. And so we did. And within a week, I was on a flight bringing this little cat home.
Jeez. Is that the picture that's here also?
That
down
is.
On
that's
the bottom?
In the Nebraska airport with her two. Her daughter is the blonde, and the little girl is her friend.
Wow.
And they were just beside themselves. Everybody was crying at the airport because it was such a nice reunion. And
sure.
It was just very touching. And that's one reason why I love doing this.
Because, absolutely.
I mean, I'm reuniting somebody with their long-lost pet.
That's an amazing story. I mean, again, just to think about how a cat would go from Nebraska to Vegas, but the leg from the Orient to here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's a hell of a swim. I mean, however the cat got here
yep.
before going from the... But in theory, let's take that out of the mix for a second. How would a stray... Why? How would a stray go that far? Let's say from Nebraska to Vegas.
It
I mean, how does
anything.
It happen?
It could be anything. If they wander into a rest stop or somebody and somebody finds them as a
and
stray...
And just picks them up?
Just picks them up and takes them with them. So
wow.
they end up...
To like
away.
Another stop or whatever.
Exactly.
Wow.
Exactly. And if, I mean, you know, unfortunately, if the cat acts up or something, they may leave it in another
sure,
state. And
sure.
then, you know, again, it just repeats.
Wow.
This is a perfect reason why you should chip your pets.
Yes.
Right.
It's
right.
painless.
Absolutely.
It's relatively inexpensive. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I mean, even if they get out or get lost... here locally,
right.
you know, it's great. All my are chipped.
Good. Because really a lot of them won't wear the collars.
Right.
And I mean, I'm a proponent of the collars because I see a cat and when I see it out loose, I'm like, oh, it doesn't even have a collar on.
Right.
So.
We have one that hangs out here. It's a black cat, mm-hmm. short hair. And
well, that explains a lot.
Yeah, a couple of weeks ago, you know, I saw him down there wandering around, and he had a collar on with a tag,
mm-hmm.
and so I picked him up, very friendly, came right up to me, and I thought, oh, okay, somebody's lost our cat, you know, because you know what the building's like here,
right.
and so we called the number, and they said, no, just let him go. They live right on the other side of the wall there, on the next street over, mm-hmm. and said, yeah, he wanders around, he'll come home when he's ready, and you know, I don't know that I would have that much faith. especially since there's a street between this back wall and their the housing area over there. But you know, I'm not a big proponent of letting your cats run wild outside. There's too many.
It's too dangerous. Yes. It really is between the cars and the traffic and bad people and animals. I mean, coyotes still wander these streets.
You bet. And once they're domesticated, you know, they really can't survive out there. No, so anyway, true. Never mind.
I hope Cammy chip Ricky when he goes out walking. Because now that he's outside walking after his recovery, he may never come back.
Does he have a limp?
He's got a limp.
Okay. Then he needs to get that other knee done.
Exactly. Well, that's a whole other topic.
Okay.
All right. So that's a great story. That's wonderful. So the cat was missing about 8 years and reunited in Nebraska. That's really cool.
Yes.
What other stories? What other tidbits we have going on?
Another one we have going on just recently. I just came back from Sioux Falls, South Dakota.
Well, Sioux Falls. Well, do they have snow up there yet already?
I don't know, but they didn't.
11 inches up here in Lee Canyon.
Really?
With the rain that we've had the last couple of days.
Well, this little girl, unfortunately, she was a puppy cat at one point. She was adopted here to a woman. The woman moved away. A couple of times she moved, but she took the cat with her.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, in the last few months, she suffered a stroke.
Oh, boy.
And she couldn't care for herself or her cat. So she asked a family member to take the cat and care for her and, you know, until she gets herself back on her feet. And I think her sister agreed, but she wasn't a cat person.
Mm-hmm.
So not too long after that, poor little Katie found herself in a kill shelter in South Dakota.
Oh, boy.
And again, the chips saved her because the chip was still registered to the woman, but to Poppy.
Right.
So they found out the story of the woman, and she was incapable of taking care of the cat.
Right.
The sister turned her in, and they were like, you know what, we're just going to call Poppy. So they did, and of course, word went out to the board again. Right. Oh, my God, one of our cats is in a kill shelter. And right there, we're just like, we have to do whatever we can to get her home.
Right, sure.
And I said, well, you guys raise the funds. I'll go.
Right.
And they put that out on our Facebook page, and I think within a day and a half, we had all the funds for the flights for me to go.
Wow.
So within a week, I was on a flight to go get her. And the poor little Katie, when we got her, because we kept her overnight when we got home, because it was too late. We got home at like 9:30. Yeah. It was just too late. But her fur was so matted, and she was just so neglected, this poor little cat. First of all, she hated flying. The 2.5-hour flight that it was pure hell. I had to hold onto the cage with one hand, and she was trying to fight out of it. We were on a flight. I have to keep remembering we're on a flight to Vegas.
Right.
So all these people are excited. They're drinking. They're having a good old time.
Here I am. Kind of riling her up.
I just want to get this cat home. And all these people are just so noisy. And she was upset. And it was a rough flight. But we finally got her home. I let her out in one of my rooms and, you know, by herself. And she calmed down a lot. The next morning when I had to bring her to Bonanza, she wanted no part of a carrier. None. She fought me tooth and nail.
Sure.
And I mean, she didn't hurt me. She was pretty much calm. But I mean, she doesn't know me. I didn't know her.
Sure.
And she was very uncomfortable. The mats were like huge on her. They just had to be
shaved off. She looked like an armadillo.
Right.
Yeah, she did.
It
was horrible.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah. So we got her up to Bonanza the next morning, and they shaved her right away just so they could see her skin condition and see how bad she was. And for the most part, she was pretty healthy. She was just neglected. She was just left to her own devices. They fed her, fortunately, but never cared for her. I'm sure they never played with her, never really cared too much what happened to her. So she made it back here just fine, and we do have one of our regular Poppy people who, once she's medically cleared with everything, is going to adopt her and give her the forever home.
Very nice.
So, yeah.
Very nice. Another happy ending there.
Exactly.
That's very cool. Now, Steve, you don't go on these trips that Sue goes on, do you?
Sometimes
yes, sometimes no?
Well, I haven't been on any yet. I've done transports. Like when we had somebody transport an animal from California here.
Okay.
And then we picked it up here, like at the M Resort, and took it up to St. George or...
Gotcha. Some more local Mesquite kind of stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
But from what I'm understanding, Christy is going to be getting another cat from Cairo, Egypt.
And another one?
Another one.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, and this one is, again, medically challenged, paralyzed... but this time, instead of flying to JFK, they're going to put her into Phoenix. So this one I'm going on.
Okay.
I'm going
to
go.
But
with
I wanted
her.
To ask, when you fly out to take these cats or pick them up or whatever, Do they let you bring them in the cabin?
Oh, yes, absolutely. Yeah. They okay. do not go in cargo.
Okay.
And that's pretty much, during the summer months, it's a law on a lot of the airlines that the animals cannot even go in cargo.
Okay.
Because it's just not safe. But
okay.
we, doing transport with cats, we don't even consider it. If they want to send it in cargo, then no.
Right.
It's just not safe.
Okay. And that was going to be my question. Yeah. I did not know that they would allow them.
Absolutely.
You know.
You do pay a fee. It's usually between $95 and $100 for okay. the pet carrier. They specify what size.
So they supply you. They
no.
supply.
No, you
but
supply
you just have to get one that's that size.
Yeah. Correct. Because okay. it has to fit under.
Has to fit under.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
And the cat can't come out during the flight. You have to leave it in the carrier no matter what. And
okay. But you can take the carrier out, set it on your lap during the
no.
flight.
No.
No.
A lot of them say it has to stand. Yeah. And these are federal regulations. So you can't mess with that.
That's what we had to do when we moved here from North Carolina. We brought our two cats with us. And we had to do that. And also, most airlines require that an animal, be it a cat or a dog, be seen by a veterinarian 72 hours prior to flight time, too.
Yeah.
So if you plan on taking your animal, to let you know, go to the vet. Because
That's cool, because I know a really good vet here in town.
Yeah, there you go.
Who is that?
Dr. Steelman,
look
over
at
Bonanza Cat Hospital.
Really?
Which I believe is associated with the Puppy Foundation.
It is, right next door.
All right, with that, we're going to step aside for a quick break. I can never adopt a cat from Egypt.
Why is that, sir?
I'm Jewish.
Oh,
anyway.
Oh, my goodness.
You're listening to Vegas Unwrapped here on Vegas All Night Radio. Now I'm going to get all kinds of letters from PETA.
Reach your hand out,
man. we'll be back with more right after this. All right, welcome back to Vegas Unwrapped. I'm just checking in on Yelp that I'm here at Vegas All Night Radio. So Vegas All Night Radio can now be found on Yelp.
And Stars of
VANR
can be found on iTunes.
Stars of VANR is on iTunes now?
Stars of VANR is now on iTunes as of today.
Wow. And you can also hear us on TuneIn, the new phone app.
And Irma's working on getting some of the videos up there as well.
All right. Very good. So
She did that too. I did not. I got a message that we're on iTunes now.
Yes, I know she's been trying to load some up there, so that's good stuff. We're on iTunes too, hot diggity dog, so to speak. All right, we've got Sue
and it's free.
And it's free, that's the best part. Sue and Steve Onorato are here talking about, if you missed before the commercial break, make sure you tune back into the podcast or on the video, sharing some of the stories on some of the local pet rescues. But you've mentioned the Poppy Foundation a couple of times in those stories. Let's spend a little time talking about the foundation, what they're all about, and what they have going on.
Yes. Actually, the Poppy Foundation has been around for quite a few years. It started with a low cat named Poppy, and she was brought into Bonanza Cat Hospital. She had some medical issues going on, and they noticed as they were treating her that she had a little head tilt. And it was cute, but unfortunately, and with animals, a head tilt usually means something neurological.
Mm.
So it wasn't really cute to them. The people that came to visit her and play with her and everything, you know, they didn't know how bad she was, but it was something very serious. So she was going to spend the rest of her time there because her owner couldn't care for her.
Mm-hmm.
And Poppy made friends while she was there. And that's how they started the Poppy Foundation.
Oh, wow.
Because people wanted to donate money to her care because she was being left there, basically. They wanted to donate food and supplies, whatever she needed to keep her comfortable for whatever time she had left. And that's how the Poppy Foundation was born.
Wow.
It started as that foundation. And then when she passed, they wanted to continue in her legacy. And then they started taking in more special needs cats. And today, we're up to well over 100 cats.
And how long has the foundation been in existence? Roughly?
What was it, 89?
Somewhere in there.
Yeah. I think it started in about 1989.
Okay.
So, yeah, quite a few years.
Okay.
But what they do today and where they've moved up to the new location at 6620 Sky Point Drive.
Okay.
Way up where the 215 and the 95 cross,
mm-hmm.
a beautiful area, and much bigger building than if anybody remembers where they were on Bonanza and Lake Mead.
Okay.
And they are in a building with Bonanza Cat Hospital, and they have their own room, and it is one big, large room that these 100-plus cats just coexist.
Wow. It's a big cat commune.
It is.
It's
amazing. And in the old place, they even had like a little scaredy cat room where it was just too crowded and these cats could not function with the other cats and everything. Wide open now. They're free to come and go. All the little scaredy cats, because I was there, I helped move them.
Yeah, sure.
That's actually when I started getting involved with them.
Wow.
And I helped move the cats from one location to another, and they started them in their own room, closed room, and pretty soon somebody had accidentally left the door open. They were wandering in and out. Everybody was fine. There was no tension.
No issues.
Nothing.
Wow.
And it was just amazing transformation.
Now, how long do the cats stay there? I mean, obviously hoping till they get adopted, I would think, right?
No. Actually, the majority of the cats that are at Poppy are not adoptable.
That's their permanent home.
Yes. That's their hospice.
Right.
Exactly.
Oh, I see. Okay.
And they are there because they either have medical or physical or psychological issues that they're just not really adoptable.
Gotcha.
They need constant medication, or they have behavioral issues that, you know, just are not going to be addressed and not be solved. And instead of adopting them out and finding them back at a shelter.
Right. They're just going to take care of them.
Exactly.
Gotcha.
So they live out their life there.
Okay.
And it's amazing when you go there. I mean, there is always, I've never been there when there wasn't at least three or four or five people in there. You know, you go to the vet's office.
Right.
And the Poppy Foundation is like right off to the left in the door there. And it's a glass door. So, you know, you see some of these cats in there that they're just like, hey, you want to come in here and play with me, man? Come on, man. And you go in there, and there's people playing with the cats, and it's, you know, to me, it's good therapy. Every time I go in there, I have to go in and play for a little bit, you know?
Sure.
So
there is actually one cat in there. He's a black cat, and his name is Steve.
You got a namesake.
And he sits right at the door, and he's got the biggest mouth. Yep. And I remember transporting him, and he was just the biggest mouth in transporting. He didn't want to go. Constantly. And then he would sit at the door with it just like half his face showing, meowing and meowing, and somebody let me out. And you know, it's not that they're being prisoner in there, but they shouldn't be out commingling. And a lot of them are safety risks. They'll run out the door. And, But you'll find if you go up to Bonanza Cat Hospital, there are lobby cats that won't try to escape or anything. They are just free wandering.
They hang out in the lobby.
And they visit with people when they come in.
Very cool.
Yes, it is very cool.
So it's really a cat sanctuary.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah, that's cool.
It's kitty nirvana, actually.
There you go. There you go.
For someone like me.
It's the cat's meow, baby.
I hope I can find a place like that.
I was going to say, that's pretty good. It'll help you wander wherever you
are. Are you listening, Sean?
Yeah. But first, we got to chip you just in case.
Yeah.
Now, they have some events coming up.
They do. We have two of our big events that we have every year. First of all, the one is on November 15th. It's a Sunday, and it's going to be a holiday bake sale. It's going to be from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. We're going to have lots of yummy homemade desserts and treats to start your holiday season. We are looking for help with some bakers and volunteers if anyone is interested in helping. We would certainly appreciate that. They can call the Poppy Foundation at 702-271-1632, or I take care of the Poppy Cat email, which is poppycatstuff@gmail.com.
Mm-hmm.
So email us, call us, let us know if you can help. Again, that was a holiday bake sale on Sunday, November 15th from 11 to 2.
And they got some good stuff, man.
They do.
They got a couple of bakers there that ought to be professionals.
A couple of them are.
Yeah.
There is one who is a dessert chef who contributes some of her yummies all the time. So you'll never know what you're going to find there. And then our major event for the year is our Christmas sale and celebration, and that is going to be December 12th and 13th. That's a Saturday and Sunday. It's a two-day event. It's from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. both days. We have lots of gift items. We have a lot of kitty items, for sure. We got the good catnip stuff, and everybody knows about that because that stuff sells out the first day, I swear, always. And we also are going to do our pictures with Santa again. It's mostly for the kitties, but well-behaved dogs are invited.
Uh-huh.
We had a goat 1 year.
We did. We had a goat.
For Easter,
So well-behaved.
For Easter, goat?
Yeah. Somebody brought in a little baby goat to take a picture with the Easter Bunny.
You're kidding.
No. I got pictures to prove it.
Kid.
Got it.
Goat. Get.
Got it.
Okay. Last time I tried my own
jokes. Just kidding a little.
Yes, just kidding a little.
But again, we do need volunteers and bakers for both of those too, so if anybody would like to come and help us. Also, with at both events, we do invite our resident kitty cat condo makers. Mm-hmm. They're called Where the Cat's At, and they make the best kitty towers and condos anywhere. They're sturdy, they're well-made, so much better than the ones you buy in the pet store.
God, yes.
And very affordable. Okay. People that have gone to our events and seen them there, they usually sell out. They usually have like one or two left by the end of the day. And they have donated a couple of them to Poppy, which
I found out
nice
the hard way that because I thought, okay, well, towards the end of the event, I'll go get that one. By the time I got there, they were all sold out.
Yep.
So the next time the one that I wanted that they had there as soon as I got there. This one's mine.
Yeah.
You know. But you yeah, and the cats love it.
Yes.
It's just, I don't know, you know, they look similar to the stuff that you see in the stores.
Right.
But I don't know, there's just something about them that...
No, they're, you know, they're so much more well-made.
Yep.
They're made with real wood. And actually, they're made with a lot of repurposed supplies.
Okay. Right.
So they are, you know, green.
Mm-hmm. Green, so you have meat. A lot of reusable...
Exactly.
...products there.
Exactly.
And they'll pretty much design anything you want.
Right.
They actually made us a castle.
Yes.
Really?
We
a
have
three-piece
a...
three-piece castle.
Three-piece castle. Mm-hmm. It's like... What is it, like 8 foot by 8 foot?
Yeah,
it's huge. Huge.
Wow. It's got a little drawbridge and everything. It's awesome.
Yeah, it is. We're sick people. We're sick.
Can they make a bat cave?
I'm sure they could.
Wow. You know, I don't have cats. Could.
That's
but.
Right.
Well, then you have to get a black cat.
I know, with wings.
Yeah.
Get them for your dogs.
My dogs. My, no. No. No, no. All right, so what we'll do... John,
what will we do?
Let's keep this handy.
Yes, please.
So that for the next couple of shows leading up this, well, we only have one more show next week before the holiday bake sale.
Right.
But certainly before the December event, let's make sure we keep announcing
this
each week.
And I'll have this stuff on the videos.
Maybe tomorrow if you've got nothing to do. for at least the Christmas sale and celebration, why don't you do a PSA recording and we'll just play it on the station.
Yeah.
Because to do one
that.
For the other one, we'll just announce it on the show next
week. Me and Ryan will do something.
Yeah,
we'll
you'll do something for that. So we'll try to drum up some business there. So, guys, thanks for coming in. Your time's up.
Time's up.
Yeah. That's just
that
like
was
that.
Quick.
I know you said so much tonight. Steve.
I know.
Next time
I know.
You come back, I want you to calm down,
I'm exhausted,
and not deal with all of this stuff.
I'm
okay?
tired.
Okay?
Well, once she gets going, she
I know. Does. Listen, last time she was on the air freaking out before we got. Oh my god, I was so nervous. I don't know what to do. Now she did the whole segment.
She's
by
a
herself.
Pro now.
I know
yeah.
She's a pro now.
She's
going to
have her own show.
That's right. That's right.
Know.
So we'll hear from these guys in the first Thursday of every month with updates on what's going on with the Poppy Foundation
and
the cats and stories
maybe,
and special guests.
Yeah, there will be a surprise guest.
Oh,
in
hey,
December.
Whatever happened to that one that you took up there to Washington? How's
oh,
he doing?
He's
Phelps.
Doing great. He's Who? Doing really good.
Cool. What's his name again?
Phelps. Yeah.
Is that the one that painted also?
Yes.
That picture,
yes.
Right?
Yes. Yes.
He's from Mission Impossible.
Yeah. Yeah. Sure, Phelps.
Yes. He's doing really
no,
well.
No, he was born with swimmer syndrome. That's
right.
How he got his name,
Absolutely.
Phelps.
Well, hopefully we'll have Phelps in studio someday in the future, because we are encouraging them to bring in some of the pets if they can, their own or whatever. As they come in to visit with us, we can show them off to our listeners. Thanks for coming in, guys.
Thanks for having
again.
Us.
Absolutely. I think we may have a Doing It With Styles award,
yeah,
even though I blew it at the top of the hour. But Mr. Bobcat, take us a break.
You got it, sir. Thank you to our good friend Stu and
See,
Steve.
It's catchy. See, it's catchy. It's not just
Stu and Eve. Stu and Eve.
Back with Doing It With Styles, and we'll take a quick look at sports as Vegas Unwrapped continues right here, everybody.
Well, hi there, everybody.
Excuse me, a little something
that?
I ate at lunch. Sorry. Welcome back to Vegas Unwrapped. Hey, I neglected to mention this, but they're still sitting here in studio. You know, I couldn't help it. I was distracted by Sue's nails. She has candy corn nails for Halloween. Isn't that cool? They did a really great job.
Thank you. I designed them.
Did you really?
I did.
You don't do it yourself, do you?
No, but my nail tech, he never knows what I'm going to come in and ask for.
So when we see you next month, you're going to have remnants of turkeys on your fingers,
probably.
Drumsticks.
Yes.
Drumsticks.
I like that. All right, you know what it's time for?
Yeah.
Even though I screwed it up at the top of the show.
That's okay. It's still worth it.
All right, Doing It With Styles. Let's do it.
It's time for Doing It With Styles.
I missed the whole song, John.
You either.
You mean that 2.5 minute intro?
I said I missed the song, not the whole intro. Guy's only guy's intro is longer than his whole segment. We actually don't get paid for this. Is it obvious?
but we do get creative at times.
Yes, we do.
Yeah. Okay, tonight. As you mentioned earlier,
yes.
We lost a someone who was very dear to my heart, and that was George Barris. George Barris was the creator of the amazing 1966 Batmobile and many other legendary whips. Barris's most famous car was surely the one Adam West drove during the Batman TV show, but he has a rich automotive history. He designed the Munster coach, the truck for the Beverly Hillbillies, which a lot of people didn't
know
that.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the modified Dodge Charger for Thunder Alley. The Batmobile sold at auction in 2013 for $4.62 million.
Jeez.
Barris had actually died early today. He was battling a brain tumor, and he was just shy of 90 years old.
Yeah, 89.
And I don't think that people realize what the effect that he's had on our culture,
right,
and automobile design and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So anyway, George, we love you. You get to doing it with styles because you certainly did do it with styles, and you will be missed. So that's all I have for this evening.
All right.
Thank you for listening to Doing It With Style. Heard exclusively on Vegas Unwrapped.
All right, I just pulled up a site, and it happens to be an eBay site, and I'm trying to find the entire list of George Barris cars that he was involved with.
I'm not sure. We've only got an hour and 2 minutes left. So.
I know.
Yeah, but go ahead.
Exactly.
Give it a shot.
How much time do we have before the top?
We have 2 minutes. 2 minutes.
I guess we better go to Vegas Unwrapped Sports Desk us to the top, Mr. Bobcat.
All right, we can do that,
sir. He did the Green Hornets car was another car. Yeah. I think I mentioned that one before. Go for it.
During the sports break, you can find out how many there are out there, okay?
I'll try to find it.
Number 4, Batmobile. Michael Goddard's got it for you if you got the checkbook for you, big guy.
I got the ones I can afford. They're about this big by this big.
Those scaled-down versions, right?
Exactly.
All right, taking a look at sports, and of course, we topped this at the beginning of the show. The Kansas City Royals are your 2015 World Series champions. The Royals knocked out the New York Mets 4-1. So we'll see how the teams, you know what I always hate about this, guys, is that these teams build these teams, they win a championship, and by next year, half the players won't even be back with the team again, man. You know what
true?
I mean? I hate when they do that crap, okay? NCAA football, number 6, Baylor up on top of Kansas State right now with just a minute or two left to go in the game, 31-24 for Baylor. Mississippi State and Missouri are 14-13, just getting ready to start the second half of that one. NFLs, it's the Battle of Ohio's tonight, gentlemen. Cleveland and Cincinnati, the unbeaten Bengals 7-0, 24-10 right now in the fourth quarter. The Bengals up on top of the Cleveland Browns. Okay, NBA action earlier tonight. Miami's a winner. Chicago, Charlotte, and a tough battle going on right now in Denver, 61-60, Denver and Utah. A full scale of NHL games are all mostly getting started late here. And also for you, NASCAR. Matt Kenseth has been suspended for 2 races when he took out Joey Logano with 9 laps to go with the paperclip at Martinsville. Kenseth will sit out at Texas and at Phoenix, okay? Jeff Gordon got his first win of the year, which means he will move on to the championship round coming up in Miami. That's a look at sports right here for you, big guy. And I've still got 30 seconds, so back to you, okay?
All right. I'm on his website. Barris.com, car
You're
growers.
Out of time.
I know I'm out of time. I know.
We have another hour, though.
Yeah, I know, but we got other guests.
Okay.
It's too bad.
How much is the cheap one on there for sale?
Oh, there's no. I'm not on the. I'm not on the site for sales.
Oh, okay.
I don't want to get depressed. I don't want to get depressed. But I mean, this, like John, you said it best. I mean, the culture that he put out there,
right.
what he affected was just amazing.
You know, he also had a lot to do with a lot of engineering through a lot of the auto racing series, too. Back into the old Seca series, a lot with NASCAR. He teamed up with the France family. So a great pioneer, just not only for show cars, but
the Munster car. He did the Munster car, too, the one with the coffin. And
That was, in fact, the drag racing one. Remember Grandpa in that one there. There you
That's
go.
That's right. All right. We must be close to the top. You're listening to Vegas Unwrapped. It is now time for the National, Mr. Bobcat.
That's it. Our first hour is down the hill, and we're ready, locked and loaded, and go for hour number 2. Aaron Phillips, Ricky Cash back at the Cash Compound, John J. Pink Styles, yours truly, the Bobcat. We come back hour number 2. You're locked and loaded right here, Vegas Unwrapped on VegasAllNetRadio.com. Time for the national break, and we're back right after this, everybody.
Oh, boy. Hour number 2.
We're almost there, man.
Are you guys tired tonight, man?
Yeah, a little sluggish day today, at least for me. I don't want to talk for John.
It's a bitch getting old, I'm telling you.
Yeah, I know John's been, you know, he runs around here with all those video work he's got to do, and Beth has been a godsend to help him with that stuff.
She's awesome.
My Thursdays.
I'd be dead now if it wasn't for her.
I start my Thursdays at 7:30 in the morning at a networking meeting at BCN. So it's like a, it was a 12-hour now, like 13, 14-hour day.
So in other words, you got started this morning of keeping Gil and Robert in line, right?
Actually, Gil doesn't attend the meetings. Robert happened to have been there today because he was the guest speaker. But I usually see Becky every Thursday morning. So, yeah, I kind of start my day with them, and then I end my day with them since they follow us here.
I got an email from Becky. She told me to keep him in line. Apparently, she's out of town again.
Yeah, she is out of town. She's actually coming back tomorrow morning. She's back in Pittsburgh on some business.
So. Oh, my goodness gracious. Cold.
Yeah. You know, 11 inches of snow has fallen here up in Lee Canyon with all the rain and everything that we've had.
No shit.
Yeah, 11 inches.
Wow.
So
about time to wax up them skis, big guy.
Yeah, not this body. I gave up skiing back in high school on those old field trips we all used to go on, the ski trips. So, all right. Well, you know what? Halloween is over.
Yeah.
Thanksgiving is right around there. I like the memes that I'm seeing on Facebook where they're kind of combining Santa Claus with people saying, look, your holiday's not till December. Yeah. Let us eat our turkey first.
Yeah.
So I kind of like that because I hate rushing through the holidays at this time of year.
I've decided that this year I refuse to go into any store or shop anywhere that has Christmas decorations before Thanksgiving.
I'm boycotting it.
You got Christmas decorations and shit up now. That's it. You ain't got my business.
I want to thank you for giving us all Thanksgiving. This will be the first time in 3 years I'll actually get to cook Thanksgiving dinner. I love to cook it, man.
So Thanksgiving Thursday, which is what, the 26th, all of our Thursday show lineup will have two options. They'll either re-air and exist a previous show, or they can work out with production to come in and pre-record a fresh show for that day. There'll be no live programming that day because we all want to be home celebrating with our families.
Well, they better hurry because we don't have that many open time slots for the pre-record.
That is very true. Stacked up next Saturday. I've got three or four of them to do next Saturday. So, and a couple this weekend.
Really? People are coming in to do pre-records?
Yeah. Irma gave me my schedule. I'm stacked. I got two to do Saturday. One, two, three to do. And three to do next Saturday.
Wow.
I think five of them. And I know Ryan's got a couple. Mr. Lawrence said he had a couple to do.
Well, then there you go. I guess people were responding to the email. That's good. All right, so let's
talk. We're just going to replay one of ours, right?
Let's
play from last Thanksgiving, right?
We should. What did I do last Thanksgiving? Well, I know we re-aired something.
We could do a real throwback Thursday, huh?
Yeah, yeah. Maybe I'll look it up in the archive because you know what? Since Vegas and Rap's been on the air, we've never gone live on Thanksgiving. I've always re-aired a show.
Well, it's a good thing because I wouldn't be here.
No, you wouldn't be here. I wouldn't be here.
I was here last year.
Yeah, you were here because somebody dogged the schedule on us last year.
Axel, man, he wasn't cutting a break at all. He says, I'm there. And then he took his kid out for turkey dinner after.
We didn't give anybody that option, so they've got.
I'll be starting my morning off with about 5:30 with a nice Bloody Mary, man. Get the old bird wrapped up and ready for the oven, man.
Wrap it in bacon.
Did you see that picture? I'm doing that.
There was a picture that I shared on my Facebook page of a turkey completely wrapped in bacon.
You know, I've done that before. You know who taught me that? Our good friend Andy Martello,
yeah, sure,
from The Price is Right,
right?
Roadshow. He does that, man. He taught me that, and it turns out really good. Get that pepper smoked bacon, big guy.
I like the applewood smoke.
Oh, yeah.
That'll never fly in my house. Not for any other reason other than the fact that who's going to be listening to the show? My dad? No, he doesn't listen. My radar is coming into town for the week of Thanksgiving.
Ah.
My dad doesn't know. We were supposed to try to surprise Robin, but that didn't work either. They blew that. But they don't eat bacon, so I wouldn't be able to pull it off.
Well, here's what you do. You wad up a big old wad of bacon,
and
you stuff it inside.
There you go.
Right? They'll
never know. There you go.
Man, this is good turkey.
It's not a bad idea. It's not a bad idea.
But if you really want to do it right, and I know just covering the outside really doesn't cut it. What you have to do is slide the bacon under the skin.
And get all the juices from the
everything, because otherwise it just runs off the skin. Yeah.
Yeah, really.
But you slide it under the skin between the turkey breast and the skin on the turkey, man.
Right. But if the gravy, if the juice from the bacon rolls off like you're saying it will,
mm-hmm,
the gravy for the turkey would be smoking.
Oh, yeah.
Bacon flavored turkey gravy.
Yeah.
That
well, still, I mean, the grease is still
going to... Yeah, take this down, would you please?
The grease is still going to... Or the bacon grease is still going to seep out.
Right.
But some of it's going to seep into the turkey, meat of the turkey itself.
Sure. Yeah.
So you get, it's a double. It's a 2-for-1, man. You get that.
Wow.
You get the
double the bacon.
Bacon turkey, turkey bacon.
Turkey bacon. Well, there is turkey bacon.
I know, but now it's bacon turkey.
Now I got one. What, now I got one
well,
thing
you get
we can
turkeys
top that.
Made out of
What's
bacon.
Okay, you cook the bacon first, right?
Okay.
And you get the grease.
Right.
And you strain the grease off. Then you get one of them injector jobs.
And
take a little bit of it and
shoot it in your vein.
Oh, into the turkey. Oh.
Yeah.
Well, but what if you shoot it in your vein? You're saving the turkey in between. You're saving the in-between party.
Yeah.
Just suck it down.
Why waste all that
That's
time?
Right. Why waste the turkey for 6 hours? Oh, my God.
No, I love turkey. I always buy 2 turkeys for Thanksgiving.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. One for the and the biggest ones I can find. One for Thanksgiving dinner.
Right.
And the other one for hot turkey sandwiches for the rest of the week.
Damn, man, you must put some bird away, man.
I do. I can eat a whole damn turkey myself.
Albertsons usually does a 2-for-1.
Yeah, I know.
Buy one, get one.
I know.
Yeah. I used to do that, but I don't have the freezer space anymore to buy the extra turkeys. Because what we used to do when I was in Kiwanis, we'd put together turkey baskets.
Right.
So we would all go to Albertsons, do the 2-for-1, so that the extra one, I just don't have the freezers. I used to have the extra garage with the extra refrigerator out there, and then you could do all that stuff.
Well, a week before Thanksgiving, I take everything out of my freezer.
Right. And make room for it?
Yeah, make room for the turkeys.
What do you have in your freezer right now?
Nothing.
So you have plenty of room.
I got plenty of room right now.
John's leaving the show tonight.
Wait,
stopping at Albertson's.
You're stopping for turkeys now.
I think I got some tater tots in there or something left over from last week or the week before.
I have about 15 containers of homemade chicken soup. Eileen made chicken soup last week.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'll swap you some diabetic cookies for the chicken soup.
Swap?
Yeah.
You have to talk to the wife on that. My wife. I'm not in control of it. I just eat it when I want it. That's it. Because she even made matzo balls with it. Oh, she did. She makes really great homemade chicken soup. She really did. And the matzo balls. It was funny when she first started making matzo balls. Like most people have trouble with, they sink.
Mm-hmm.
But she's learned over the years what to do so that they float and they're light and they're fluffy.
You put a helium balloon in the middle.
Exactly. Inject with helium gas.
Yeah. Works every time.
So we've got tons of containers of chicken soup in the house. So I can't eat that much chicken soup. So we're going to try to make some space. But we're going to have some.
I like chicken soup.
We're going to have some folks. We'll send you a couple of quarts.
Yeah.
We're going to have some folks
good,
over.
Because I might get sick.
Gee, many Christmas, man. You're going to send him a couple of quarts. I offer you a swap deal here.
Well, no.
Yeah, but I'm sick.
Tell us something that we don't know. Mrs. Phillips, I'm willing to swap. I'm willing to swap so that I can get your husband off of these M&Ms and all this. I'm willing to swap.
Great.
I threw you under it.
Now you want chicken soup after throwing me under the bus?
Well, you're going. I was willing to work a trade with you. And you're just going to throw it to the sick guy over there. How about some Vegas Unwrapped treasures?
Chicken soup for the brain, right?
Chicken soup for the brain. Jewish penicillin, as they call it.
Yep.
All right, let's do some Unwrapped Treasure. Let's share some things of what's going
on
in this
town. Why not? We're not doing anything else.
We're not doing anything else, eh? We're just bullshitting here.
Yeah.
Hey, you know what starts tonight, the 5th? Started tonight at 5 o'clock. Runs
Remember,
all
the
way.
5th of November.
Yeah, what is that all about?
You don't know what that's all about?
No.
Didn't you see the movie V?
No.
All right.
There you go.
Guy Fawkes.
Okay.
You know who Guy Fawkes was?
No.
You ever heard of England?
Yes.
Okay.
It's over near China somewhere, isn't it?
Yeah, on the other side of the water.
Right.
Basically, he was, I guess you might call him an anarchist.
Okay.
Was going to blow up Parliament.
Oh.
Kind of a, he's kind of a folk hero over there.
Okay.
Rent the movie or go to Netflix or whatever and watch the movie V.
Okay.
With, what's her name? Natalie Portman.
Okay.
And you'll understand.
All right. I will do that.
Okay.
All right, hey, you know, the Ethel M. Holiday Cactus Garden.
Hey, what starts today?
Ethel M. Holiday Cactus Garden started tonight. Goes all the way through the holidays. Bring the family out to celebrate the season at the 22nd annual Ethel M. Holiday Cactus Garden. This is always popular attraction, features more than 600,000 holiday lights, carefully strung across 300 species of native desert plants. Holiday music, visits from Santa Claus, and free tours of the chocolate factory. With a sweet treat at the end in the gift shop, make this a must-do attraction for locals.
It's pretty cool.
The Illuminated Cactus Garden is open from 5 p.m. to 10 p.m. on a nightly basis, and that's down at 2 Cactus Garden Drive down in Henderson.
Of course.
Let's see. I'm trying to find. Oh, you know what? Tomorrow night is the monthly First Friday events.
Yep.
1228 South Casino Center Boulevard. Of course, that's where all the fine artists and singers and everything. It officially starts at 5 p.m. and goes till 11 p.m.
You know who else is going to be down there?
Who?
Hot Diggity Dog.
Hot Diggity Dog is going to be down there?
Hot Diggity Dog. Hot Diggity Dog is a hot dog food truck.
Wow.
One of the closest I've found to Pink's in Hollywood.
Really?
Yeah. Excellent chili dog.
Never.
And you know
there.
Who owns that?
Who's that?
The drummer for Strawberry Alarm Clock, Gene Bernal.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
Go down there. You know who else is there?
You learn something new every day.
Yeah. You know who else is there?
Who's that?
Siren Strings.
Yeah, but what's her name's not there anymore. Marlo. I'm friends with Marlo now on Facebook.
Yeah, I know.
What, she quit him?
There, they made it. She, whatever. They decided to make a little split, or guess, or whatever, so... Hey, Pause LV charity event over at Tivoli Village tomorrow night at 7 p.m. Pause LV is hosting a charity event at the William Carr Art Gallery. Tickets are $40, and the evening will entail food, drink, live music, and a silent auction. All the proceeds from the event will go to the cause for helping low-income senior and ill pet owners get free or discounted services for their pets, including spay, neuter, vaccines, and emergency medical support. So that's down there at Tivoli Village.
Speaking of which,
yes.
We forgot to mention at the Poppy Foundation.
Yes.
Just so that we don't mislead the people.
Please.
They do have adoptable cats there.
Yeah, they're all not sick cats.
Not all of them.
Right.
There are some that are adoptable, and they're pretty cool.
Mm-hmm.
So go
you can do
a cat.
That. November 7th.
Adopt, don't shop.
November 7th, 9:30 to 4:30 at the Clark County Library, 1401 East Flamingo Road. Is the 8th Annual Vegas Valley Comics Book Festival, co-sponsored by the Las Vegas Clark County Library Foundation and Pop Goes the Icon Main Theater, Jewel Box Theater, large conference room, small conference room, and the theater courtyard. The Vegas Valley Comic Book Festival returns with a day chock full of activities celebrating comic book culture. It is a free event.
When is that again?
That is the 7th. That is on Saturday.
I got to go down there.
There you go. I will be, actually, you know what? Courtesy of April Freed,
right?
I have my first gig.
Bat mitzvah?
I have the bat mitzvah of Susan Feldman.
Cool.
To help MC
it's
her.
It's not her bat mitzvah.
No, it's her daughter's.
Yeah, that's
it's
what I daughter's. Thought. Yeah, I thought maybe she was kind of past that.
No, well, you know, it's not unheard of for an adult to become a bat mitzvah if they didn't do it at 13.
Gotcha.
It's also some tradition that on certain anniversaries of one's bar or bas mitzvah that you can go and kind of renew your vows, so to speak.
Okay, are you saying bar / bat mitzvah?
Bar mitzvah is for a boy,
right?
And bas mitzvah,
yeah, that's
is
what
for
I
a
meant.
Girl.
You were,
yes,
saying bar bat, and I,
right,
was thinking
I was bar
mitzvah / bat. Yeah,
right. I was bar mitzvah. My daughters were bas mitzvah.
Right.
So,
gotcha.
Just
checking.
If you don't know what that is, folks, you can look it up on Google.
Right.
Sammy Davis Drive Festival Plaza in Lorenzi Park is going to be the host of the Wine, Cheese, and Chaplain. That's the 7th at 7 p.m., a cultural history film series celebrating 100 years of our film culture's worship of a timeless icon by revisiting a few of Charlie Chaplin's classic silent films made between 1916 and 1917.
Wow.
Part of the magic of Chaplin's films comes from their meticulousness and deliberate grace that could only come from a master artist who took his time controlling every creative aspect to effortlessly elicit laughs from even the most hardened cynic.
You know who I always wanted to see?
Who's that?
Him and Buster Keaton in the same movie. That would have been cool.
Yeah, that would be pretty good. Let's see what else is going on that I can mention that's sort of unique. What is this one? I must have missed that one. This is a Blanchine celebration from Tchaikovsky to Rogers and Hart to Gershwin. This is at the Smith Center, November 7th from 7:30 to 9:30. From the ballet master who redefined classic ballet comes three of his most iconic works, Serenade, Slaughter on 10th Avenue, and Who Cares? Sounds like Who's on First.
That's going to be a tough choice,
yeah,
because that's the same day as the comic book.
Yeah, I know. Well, but comic book is earlier in the day. This is at night.
Oh, okay. Then I can do
you
both.
You can do both.
Yeah, I love Gershwin.
The celebration begins with his first American ballet, Serenade, featuring a timeless score from Tchaikovsky. Slaughter on 10th Avenue, the tale of Broadway dreams, Russian dancers, and the mob from the Rodgers and Hart comedy On Your Toes salutes Balanchine's triumphs on both stage and the silver screen. So if you're into ballet, head down there on that. That sounds pretty cool. And I think that's going to just about do it for our abbreviated version of Unwrapped Treasures. Lots going on in this. You're never going to want for activities in Las Vegas. That's for darn sure.
That's so cool about it.
And if we haven't proved that in 6.5 years being on the radio, what the hell are you listening to?
Yeah.
That's what I got to say. All right, anyway, you're listening to Vegas Unwrapped, coming to you live from the studios at Vegas All Net Radio here in Las Vegas. Don't go anywhere. Our next guest will be in studio right after this. All right, welcome back to Vegas Unwrapped.
Thanks for having us.
Hey. Glad the invitation was accepted. Otherwise, I'd be talking to myself,
yeah.
Which I normally do anyway.
Yeah, I was
going to
say, what's new?
Especially in my office, for crying out loud.
Is that what you were doing the other day ago when I walked by? You were talking to yourself?
Probably.
Okay.
Probably. All right. We're waiting for our guests to show up. In the meantime, courtesy of Mrs. Bobcat, who handles our social media on Vegas Unwrapped Internet Radio's Facebook page. I want to thank her for her due diligence on that.
She or as I like to call her, Hot Wheels.
Hot Wheels, yes. 13 places for you to stand up and shine at open mic night in Las Vegas.
Wow. Cool.
So if you've ever thought of wanting to start a comedy career or, as John pointed out, a radio career by getting practice on the mic here.
Absolutely.
And then come over to us and do a radio show. It's
you
perfect.
Know, that might be something that we want to think about doing.
An open mic show?
Yeah.
People come on here and
yeah.
do their comedy. Well,
they get 5 minutes or
I have a show in the works with somebody that is pending. So that's what they do.
Never mind.
So we may already kind of have that in the works.
Never mind.
All right. So here are some of the top places in town. If you're in town or you want to come into town and give it a shot, no particular order other than the simple fact that this is just how they're listed on the website.
Yeah.
The Beat Coffee House at Emergency Arts on Fremont Street in downtown Las Vegas hosts the Battle Born Poetry Slam.
Whoa.
Every second Friday. Sign-ups start at 6:30 p.m. and the poetry off, I guess, begins at 7:30. There's Boomers.
You know, tomorrow is Poets Day.
Is it?
Yeah.
Is it National Poets Day? One of those national things?
No. It's every Friday is Poets Day.
Where?
Everywhere.
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Piss on everything. Tomorrow's Saturday.
Okay. P-O-E-T. All right. Boomers on Sirius Avenue hosts an open mic every Wednesday night. Doors open at 9:30, and it is hosted by Misa Crimson. Let's see. Down on Main Street, you have Hop Nuts Brewing. They host an open mic night with the Human Experience. Sign-up starts at 6:30 p.m. Open mic is from 7 to 10 p.m. Body Poetry follows from 10 p.m. till close.
Did you say body poetry?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
Might have to check that out.
Yeah, well, you know. Kelly Clinton hosts open mic night every Monday at 9 p.m. at the Bootlegger Italian Bistro. This is one of the classiest open mic nights mics in the city, and you never know who might show up to perform. You know, Bootlegger's down at the south end of the boulevard.
Which has some awesome food.
It has some good food there. And the last comment about you never know who's going to show up. There are a lot of great people that frequent that place.
A lot of good talent.
So it is true. Yep. You never know who's going to show up there.
Yep.
Coffee Tier Me on West Sahara Avenue hosts open mic every Wednesday night. The evening begins with music at 8 p.m., poetry at 8, and comedy around 9:30 or 10 p.m. Why are they considering poetry?
Everybody's doing poetry?
I guess. That's news to me.
That's what we should do. We should have a poetry radio show.
That they tried that here one time.
So?
Okay.
That was the previous owners.
Okay. How well did that go?
I said they tried that here one time.
City Bear near East Sahara Avenue in South Maryland Parkway hosts Miss Mesa, M-E-S-E, Make Every Sunday Superb, open mic comedy at 9 p.m. every Sunday at the City Bar. Did I say bear? I think I said bear. City Bar, jeez.
Yeah, I thought you said
bear. No, it's City Bar.
Okay. Is it a bear bar?
It doesn't say anything about clothes, so who knows.
Clothing optional.
We're clothing optional.
At the City Bar.
Hey, we
at
should make a radio bar. Show like that. We could have a clothing optional radio show, right?
Oh, there you go. Yeah,
and
why
we'll
not?
Videotape
just no
that.
No videotaping that one.
We had a fetish expert here last night.
I know we did. I can't wait to watch the video on that one.
It's up.
I'm sure it is. I'm sure it is.
She scared the hell out of what's his name. Poor Jeff, man. He was about to fly out of here, man. He didn't like them hairy armpits.
Oh, see, I saw. Yeah, that turns me. Hairy armpits turn me off.
I can't. Sorry, man.
I don't care how good looking they are, but once I see the hair under there, I'm out. Rhonda Carr's Event Center hosts Swingin' Sundays from 5 to 8 p.m. every Sunday. It is an open mic for professionals. Performers include Catherine Arianoff, Steve Poncar, Joni James, Gret Gonzalez, Steve Johnson, and others. An occasional guest vocalist.
Steve Johnson? Yeah. The saxophone player?
I guess it doesn't say what.
Dude's really good.
All right.
He is really good.
I'll take your word for it. Shakespeare's Grill and Pub hosts the Overtime Comedy Show every Monday night, hosted by Charlie Stone. It begins about 30 minutes after Monday night's football game.
We should have a radio show like that, you know, like a comedy show.
I think we already have one in the works. Free admission, $4 draft specials. The Hard Hat Lounge on Industrial Road hosts open mic comedy every Monday night.
Hey, that's pretty cool.
What's that?
Hard Hat, Industrial Road.
Yeah, works out.
Wow. Is Axel hanging out there?
Sign up. He's MIA right now. Sign-ups begin at 8 p.m. and performances begin at 9, hosted by Bobby Stouts. Must be 21 and older. How about the Dive Bar on South Maryland Parkway?
Yeah.
Hosts Just Effin' Comedy every Tuesday night. There's a featured act each week, as well as those who sign up to perform, and a $50 prize is awarded to best comic.
Wow.
Ooh.
Open mic night takes place every Thursday night at Money Plays. Sign up for the Money Mic starts at 8 p.m. Performances start at 9, and also there are cash prizes. Brentwood Cafe and Tavern.
Ricky cash prizes?
No, Ricky gives out the prizes.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah. Brentwood Cafe and Tavern near Warm Springs Road and South Rainbow Boulevard hosts a casual acoustic open mic every Sunday night. There is no cover charge. And last but not least, musicians or music lovers should head to Mulligan's Landing on North Rancho Drive on Friday nights for open mic night. Music begins at 9 p.m. So if you are an aspiring individual who wants to read your poetry, do comedy, play instruments, you just got a rundown of some of the best places in town to where you can take advantage of open mic nights.
Cool.
Sounds good, right?
You know, that's the awesome thing about this town is I can't think of another town, or don't know of any other town in this country, in the world,
right,
that has the diversity of things to do that we do.
No question. I mean, totally agree.
We run the gamut. If you just want to go out and look at a great big old dam, you can do that.
I'll tell you, it's funny. I remember when I first came out here to Vegas on a convention for Kiwanis. Yes,
right.
We took the tour out to Hoover Dam, and this was during the days where you can still take the walk tour downstairs underneath.
Right.
So the funny thing is that I took a picture. My wife was maybe 30 yards from me, and I took a picture from her vantage point that looked like I was just taking a picture of my feet.
Right.
And I didn't tell her what I was doing until we got the pictures back, when she saw that I was standing in Nevada and Arizona at the same time. I was standing on the state line on the dam. So that was unique. I mean, look, one of the missions we've always had when we started Vegas Unwrapped was we want to let the world know that there's more, there's more diversity in this town than people realize.
Oh, yeah.
That's the beauty of it.
Yeah. And we don't live in the hotels.
No. I had to tell people I was not pitching a tent between Bally's and Harrah's to live.
You know? I got friends of mine who still think I live at the Rio, man.
Shit. Jeez. So anyway, all right. We still got a couple of minutes. Let me see if I can find another. I didn't like that other one about where to take pictures. I just looked at it. So we're going to skip it. I'm not going to do it.
Yeah, right there.
I'm not.
Well, you know, probably.
What are you going to do, fire us?
Well, you know what? Probably one of the most famous places to have your picture taken is the Foundation Room.
Well,
over that balcony.
Yeah, well, believe it or not, that didn't make the list.
Really?
There were only three or four on the list. Number one was the first one was the Link.
Right.
Eiffel Tower.
Right.
The Stratosphere.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because the views of the Strip, not necessarily, I mean, yeah, you could get a pretty good view from up there for those from the Foundation Room.
You ever been up there?
Oh. Who's that? Is that our guest? Waving? Yep. There she is.
Have you ever been up there?
To the Foundation Room?
Yeah.
No, I have not.
Oh, man. It is a great place to enjoy a nice cold bottle of water, freshman, and just to hang out for a few minutes.
Yeah, one of my networking groups has actually started doing stuff up at the Foundation Room for socials and things like that. So I just haven't been able to take advantage of it personally. So
If you're going to eat dinner there, take the big checkbook with you.
Take the big checkbook?
Yeah, big checkbook.
All right, since our guest is arriving, Mr. Bobcat, why don't we go to break so we can get her settled?
Okay.
And we'll come back with our guest, so take it away.
We can do that. We're working on that second hour down at the bottom of it, and you've got more coming up with our next guest is ready to join us here on Vegas Unwrapped, Studio 1A, the brand new VegasAllNetRadio.com with Aaron Phillips, the Cash Man back at the Cash Compound, John J. Peg Styles, yours truly, the Bobcat. Stand by. Back right after this, everybody.
All right, welcome back. Leonard Nimoy found our guest. This is a very confusing complex if you've never been to our studio.
It is a very complex complex.
And they didn't put enough darn elevators and escalators in this place. Yeah, you know that, John Stiles?
Yep.
It's a workout to get here, trust me.
It is, absolutely.
We do trust you. We do it every day.
I try to do it only twice. Once to come up, once to go down. Yep. That's it. I don't do it in between.
And what's a bummer is Monday, after being gone for the weekend,
right.
I got to find my way back on Mondays.
What, to get up and down the steps?
Yeah.
I know.
So
it's
you
like,
had a heavy weekend. You can't remember.
Exactly.
Yep, got one of those. Yep.
The voice you're hearing is the owner of Ranieri Construction. Stacey Rinieri is here joining us in studio. You can check him out online at RanieriConstructionLLC.com. They've only been in business in Las Vegas since 1974. They're a fly-by-night company. No, I'm only kidding. Actually, Stacey came to my attention through a mutual friend that I network with. There's a couple of unique things here, Stacey, and I'd love to talk about them. First of all, I bet our audience is kind of surprised to hear that a female owns a construction company.
It's not terribly common.
Right, to say the least.
We've only
met one other person that we know of, Pat. Who was even in the handyman construction industry, Pat Stacey.
I know a few.
Well, you've been in the construction industry.
But not all of them are up front.
Right.
The ones who really run the company are the ones who people think run the company are just figureheads and, you know, so.
Well, I'm the Ranieri. I am the company.
Yeah. No. I'm familiar with your company.
I have to say, though, my husband was the Ranieri. I gained that by marriage.
Right.
So, but I'm blessed to have all of his teachings and knowledge and guidance to get me to where I am today.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So talk about how the company started. Again, you can go to their website, get some of it, but talk about the background of the company and, quite frankly, how and why you've been successful in maintaining the company for basically 40 going on 42 years.
Yes.
Through three or four.
Yeah, really. Through a couple
give
of changes.
Give or take. We're aging me now, guys. Let's go back. Well, when I met my husband back in 1974,
okay.
Of course, he wasn't my husband. I met him.
There you go.
He was in the construction industry. When I was growing up, my father was also in the construction industry.
Okay.
So growing up, I was attuned to hammers and nails and all that sort
of
thing.
Part of the daily activities.
Part of my daily activities. I helped build in basements when I grew up in Salt Lake City.
Okay.
I made my own arrows when my father decided the four children needed to learn how to shoot bow and arrows.
Oh, wow.
So we made our arrows. We glued on the feathers. We painted them. That was my fun part, was the painting.
Oh, there you go.
Things like that growing up. So when I met my husband in 1974 and he told me he was a contractor, I just kind of lended his direction because that was things that I kind of had in my blood, I guess you could say.
Mm-hmm.
It was so funny. When I first met him, he wanted to build a camper. He wanted to buy a camper shell for his 1972 Ford pickup truck. And we went looking and everything out there was thin aluminum
crap.
He said, I'm not buying this. They want all this money. I'm going to build my own. So we bought plywood. We cut the curved frames. We put, we heated and curved the skins.
Okay.
And then we put the fiberglass and everything. And we built this, pardon my French, but extremely ugly camper shell. But it was very inexpensive and quite unique and functional. And in doing that, I said, boy, I really enjoyed this.
Okay.
I got to do this some more. And he said, well, I got a tile job I got to do. Why don't you come and learn how to tile? So he showed me how to tile. I finished the shower. One thing led to another. And the next thing you know, I'm building custom homes with him.
You were in.
I was in.
There you go.
Right up my alley.
It's funny. My wife, Robin, she grew up in that industry. Her father owned this huge hardware store in New York City in the hardware district. And she loves to, now my wife can't build houses like you can, but she loves the construction aspect of putting stuff together and just the thought process. Me, just tell me where to put the nail in the wall for the picture. That's all I need to know. Just draw the X and I'll get it right there. I think that's great. I mean, you know, to be introduced into the industry. Now, primarily you're recognized for home building? Is that how it got started?
Well, back in those days, my husband's passion was custom homes. Okay. So that's what we did. We focused on custom homes. We were primarily a referral business. We never advertised. It was all referral. In between, we would do remodeling. We'd do room additions, garage enclosures, mm-hmm. conversions. You know, you name it, we did it all. But that was our passion, and mm-hmm. that's what we enjoyed doing. I recently lost my husband in March from bone cancer.
Oh, wow. Sorry. Our condolences.
But when we found out he had bone cancer, we started gearing back to the remodeling portion. Okay. Which is my passion. Okay. I love kitchen and bath remodeling. Of course, because being a woman, I enjoy the decorating part of it all. I am also a designer. So okay. that's really where my passion is. Do I do all the rest? Yes, I can and I do. But that's where my passion is.
So primarily, the company now is more heading into that direction, or do you still do some new home construction stuff?
We haven't done a new home. It's still, you know, fresh, mm-hmm. In several years, because from 1997 to 2007, we had a contract with Home Depot. Oh. We installed doors for Home Depot.
Okay.
So because the custom home building industry was kind of slowing down, mm-hmm. it was getting too costly. People were buying more pre-constructed homes.
Right.
And so during that time, I think we did two custom homes, but we relied primarily on the door installs for Home Depot.
Wow.
But then when that slowed down and when the crash came, we were actually Mrs. and Mr. Mike's handyman service.
Really?
From 2009 to 2012, 2013. That's when we found out my husband had bone cancer.
Wow.
So then we were gearing back to the remodeling portion of it. Still, people can buy a track home quite less expensive than a custom home.
Mm-hmm.
So I just gear myself that direction right now.
Wow.
It's an evolving process.
You go on the website, RanieriConstructionLLC.com, and you click on the services tab, and you'll see pretty much everything that she just talked about, kitchen remodeling, bathroom remodeling, room addition, etc., all the way down. And you can actually see all that there and get a sample. There's pictures. There's all kinds of stuff here to get an idea of what is going on and what you can do with the company. Now, do you have any notable projects going on now in town?
I'm just about to start a new project for a young lady and her husband. They've bought a new home. We're going to do extensive remodeling.
Okay.
Full kitchen remodel, some master remodel, flooring, paint, a few wall areas taken out,
mm-hmm.
Lighting, relocating, and so forth. That's kind of where I like to be.
Okay.
I've done a lot of full home remodels. Have just finished two, a kitchen remodel,
mm-hmm.
a full bath remodel. I've had five projects going right now, two in Henderson, two in Summerlin, and one at way out north. It's fun. I go through like, I think, a tank of gas in about every 2 days.
Yeah, I know the feeling. Yeah.
I think I get 14 and a half miles a gallon in my Dodge Dakota.
Wow. Oh, wow.
But
when you're doing the remodels, what advice could you give to people as far as what is the most cost-effective way to increase the value of your house? What things can you do in that house to make it worth more without spending more money than you're going to get a return on your investment?
As a return.
Yeah.
That's interesting, because when it comes to appraisals, I've always been kind of baffled by appraisals.
Yeah. Well,
people put brand new cabinets, new countertops, new sink, fixtures, the whole gamut, and they might put $40,000 in a kitchen, and yet an appraisal comes back at 10.
Yeah.
They put $60,000 to $80,000 in a pool, it comes back at 20.
Yeah.
I've never really quite understood the appraisal part of things, but the types of things they can do inexpensively that will help the home sell. It's not necessarily going to get them more money.
That's where I was going with that. Right.
But for example, paint.
Right.
Paint's inexpensive. just a fresh coat of paint on your walls, on your doors, your trim, your base, that can really bring the and neutral colors. Don't go crazy with reds and dark browns and things, because that's a specific
taste. I've walked
into
houses where this wall's ketchup and that one's mustard.
Exactly.
And I mean, that's exactly what I thought when I walked in the house. I go, holy crap, what were you thinking?
Condiment
fetish. Hopefully the buyers can see past that.
Right.
Which I'm
and
able to.
And too many of them don't.
But a lot of people can't. They walk into a home and they say, oh, I can't live with that. I don't like that.
Right.
They don't see that those are the minor inexpensive things they can change. What will help them value-wise are updated cabinetry, hardware, sinks, fixtures, countertops. I mean, if I live in Desert Shores. When I bought my house in Desert Shores 15 years ago, it had the old whitewash cabinets, had the old white 4x4 tile throughout. I yanked it all out. I put in granite countertops. I refinished the cabinets. I didn't actually take them out and replace them because they were good structured cabinets. Mm-hmm. I refinished them to give them the weathered look. Mm-hmm. And I took out the center panels and all the uppers, and I put in glass and put a little rope detail. I mean, that's the lesser expensive way to go, and yet makes a huge impact on a resale value, and as far as I am concerned, with an appraisal value.
What about countertops? You had mentioned countertops and granite. I know granite's very popular. What hard surfaces that would you say might compete with that? Or because I know Corian was popular for
Corian
quite a while.
Was very popular through the late 80s, early 90s.
Yeah.
Corian is dated now. The difference between granite or solid hard surfaces, granite and quartz, to Corian is not as durable. If you set a hot pan on Corian, it's going to burn.
Right.
You can set a hot pan on granite or quartz, which quartz is granite crushed with glues and polymers. You can set a hot pan on that and nothing's going to happen. But with granite and quartz, if you set something with an oil towards the bottom and let it sit there for a period of time and pick it up, you're going to see the ring from the oil.
Right.
It will dissipate over time. You can seal your granite and your quartz regularly, and that will help prevent that. But granite and quartz, to me, are your two most durable surfaces. You have the old laminates, formica.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You know, that's your very low-end apartment complex.
Exactly.
Surface in a kitchen.
Right. Top mount or undermount on the sinks?
That's kind of a preference. Generally, we do undermounts because people, women, like myself, we want it easy and quick and to clean.
Right.
The minute you do a drop-in, now you can't get that.
You got that little hump on the
edge. Yeah, you got that hump over the edge, and you can't get things down in there neat and clean to just swoosh stuff down into the sink. So undermounts are primarily what we're doing. We're doing a lot of farm sinks these days. A lot of people going back to that farm sink look. They like the skirted front, the different textures, the different styling. Stainless steel, obviously, is very popular, but the more and more people are using that, the more they're finding it spots very easily.
Mm-hmm.
It's if you want it look pristine, you got to be like me. I'm a little bit OCD. I wipe everything down that's stainless every time I use it.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
How about black? For your countertops and sinks.
I have had a few people, we've not used black. Well, I have used black on an island.
Right.
And actually that particular job was up in Sin City, and they actually had Corian initially. We refinished the cabinets. They kept the Corian on the base, on the major back portion of the kitchen, and then the island, we changed that Corian out to black granite. It was beautiful, and they went with a stainless sink and a nice stainless gooseneck faucet. It was beautiful. It's beautiful. You can see that one, that particular kitchen, on my website.
Okay, cool.
And then we did stone on the back side of the island. Turned out very nice. Very nice.
All right, I want to stop right there. We're going to step aside for a quick break, and then we come back. We're going to talk about something that a little birdie told me not too long ago about Stacey.
Was it a parrot?
We may see her on TV in the near future.
Really?
Yeah.
Cool.
Can't say where or what.
I can dig it. I can see that. Yeah.
Lady knows her stuff.
She'd make a good TV star.
Absolutely.
As you would say, man, we're rounding the clubhouse turn. The final segment of Vegas Unwrapped right here on Vegas All Net Radio is coming up next. A little bit more about our decorating and remodeling.
coming up. Stick with us, everybody.
Yeah, I tell you what, anybody that doesn't know where the Vince Lombardi Trophy and what year he passed away shouldn't even be watching or listening to sports. I'm going to tell you.
All right, welcome back to Vegas Unwrapped.
He thinks just because he got that knee worked on, he's out of the lock.
Before we get back to Stacey here, we have somebody on the line who decided to finally dial us.
Oh, is he sobered up?
He's sobered up, or he's woken up, or whatever. What you doing, man? You don't return text messages, nothing. What's going on?
Well, I left my phone at home. Tammy and I got taken out for dinner tonight.
Oh.
And I was able to manage the restaurant, so I might be not too long before you see me back in the office.
Well, that's good. That's good. So you're
managing a restaurant now?
No.
It's great, John. What's going on, guys?
What restaurant did you go to?
We went to Joe's Crab Shack.
Oh, very nice. Mm. Very nice. We have...
Did you walk?
Yeah, I was able to walk pretty well.
Cool.
We have Stacey Rinieri. She's the owner of Ranieri Construction sitting in with us right now. She came to me through a mutual friend that I network with, and we're just about to get to the last bit of interview with her because apparently she's been selected to appear on some TV show not too far down the line that'll be airing someday soon, and we wanted to talk a little bit about that. So we're just about at the end of that, and we had... Pet Rescuers on in the first hour, and a lot of good conversation tonight. You'll have to catch the podcast.
Will do. So this is just a quick hello, goodbye.
Hello,
and,
goodbye.
We will talk over the weekend.
Okay, check your emails, man. I've sent you some stuff I need your thoughts on.
Yes, I know. I saw them, and I will respond on that soon.
All right, very good. All right, I'm glad you're up and about going to restaurants, man.
Take care, Cash Man.
All right, well, we'll see you soon.
All right, brother.
Take care, guys.
All right. Well,
bye, Cashman.
That's good news to hear that Ricky actually went out to a restaurant.
That's awesome,
he just had knee replacement surgery.
Oh, okay.
So he's
going to be... Yesterday.
Yeah.
No.
Whoa, I want to recoup for that fast.
September 28th is when he had the surgery on one knee, and then he still has to have the other one done.
Oh, wow.
If you want to call for a free quote from Stacey and her company, you can call 702-376-7980 is the phone number. You get a free quote for all the work that you want to do, or you can simply go to their contacts tab on their page and you can send a message in with phone number and what your message is and what you want to have done, and they'll respond to your request. So we only have about 4 minutes left of the show, so let's talk a little bit. I know you can't name the show or anything, but you're going to appear on a show that's on television, obviously, in the coming couple of weeks or whatever it's going to be. How did you get selected for the show? How did you come about to get involved with the show?
I received an email and a phone call from the producer, and they asked me if I'd be interested in bidding on this job for a television show. They were going to select four local contractors to bid on this job.
Okay.
And long story short, I was selected. My bid was selected, and I was offered the job, and
great.
I did the job.
Great. So I was just going to ask, so the job has been completed and done?
It's completed.
And so obviously the film, there was filming going through from the point of, did they film from the point of turning in the estimate and all that stuff, or just the end result of you doing the project?
We filmed from the beginning of the project through the end of the project.
Oh, so it was just the project.
The actual project was filmed from start to finish.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Was it a private home or was it a business?
It was a private home.
Okay.
Private
Very
home.
Very cool.
And actually, I'm just finishing up some more work for the couple that we did that particular
Great.
Show job for as an extension of that original work.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So as we talked about before we went on the air, they haven't given you an air date yet.
They've not yet given me an air date. They've said by the end of the year.
Oh, okay. Well, that's limiting itself to about 7 more weeks. I mean, you know.
I know. It's been kind of grueling and drooling. We thought it would be on by now, but,
sure.
You know, I'm not in control of the networks.
Right. Of course not. Of course not.
Mm-hmm. Did you get paid on time?
Yes, I did.
Okay.
I got paid very well. In fact, they were quite excited how I handled the job. I ended up saving them money to the point where they were able to do 11 extra separate projects.
Wow.
pretty close to their original budget.
I would dare say that the producers of the show probably had it written down that the people who were going to get the job done for them, mm-hmm. there had to have been payment arrangements to make certain that the contractor would be paid.
Within the contract, there was a payment schedule. Right. Absolutely,
okay,
yes.
Good, otherwise it would mm-hmm. really look bad for everybody if they don't pay after being on TV and everything.
Not if it doesn't air.
That's true, not if it doesn't air, but you know, we don't want to look for that. So,
should try that, you know.
What's that?
Well, we get some people in here to do some work in the studios, and we tell them that we'll talk about your job all the way through.
Yeah, there you go. Why not? And of course, as of right now, you mentioned we're not at liberty to actually talk about what show or the name. Not even the name of the show. Is it a show that's already on, or is this just a brand new concept show?
This is their second season for this particular show.
Oh, so it's an existing show.
It's an existing show.
And you can't mention the show?
I can't mention the
show.
Really?
Even though the show's been on the air?
Yeah. Oh, wait, this particular episode hasn't aired.
No, I know the episode hasn't, but the show in general itself.
Yeah, but if I mention, then it's going to expose a particular episode for that show.
Gotcha.
For Vegas.
Okay. Fair enough. So be on the lookout for it. So certainly when you get the release date, please let us know.
I certainly will.
So we can let everybody else know to keep an eye out for you. That's pretty cool. That's very exciting. I'm mm-hmm. happy for you guys.
That's
tremendous.
Thank you. The
band is strumming, which tells us we're running out of time. We're down. Unfortunately, we didn't get to weird news tonight. That's okay, because we had a lot of good topics during the 2 hours. Want to thank Sue. I almost said Stu again. Sue and Eve. Sue and Steve Onorato, pet rescuers extraordinaire. Again, just as a reminder, they'll be joining us on the first Thursday of every month talking about some of their rescues and the Poppy Foundation. Is there a website for the Poppy Foundation? I meant to ask.
Yes.
So
you can
look
Google
up the Poppy
Foundation. It'll pop right up there.
It'll pop.
Poppy pop will yep. right up.
There you go. There you go. So check it out.
And I'm not kidding.
No. No kidding going on here at all. So, and again, as a reminder, as John mentioned earlier, coming back from our national break, we do want to mention that there are cats available for adoption. It's not just for the sick cats. Next week's show, we had a guest scheduled, but I have to reschedule to do a pre-record. Jennifer Romas, who is the choreographer and owner of the Sexy Show down at Westgate, they just changed their shows now, starting last week, to 7 p.m. every night, except for the nights Sunday and Monday, I think it is, that they're off. So we have to schedule a pre-record, which I'm working on for her to air, for that to air later on in a couple of weeks. So,
cool. So
as of right now, I have no guests for next week, but we'll fix that as the week progresses.
We'll figure something out.
Yeah, well, we always do.
Yeah.
All right.
Something will poppy up.
Poppy up. She's fitting right in. I like
this. Yeah, there you go.
That's it. We may have to make this a regular thing. Bobcat, good job tonight. Want to thank all of our listeners tonight. Mr. Cash, thanks for calling in. JPEG, good job tonight. And we want to thank everybody for following Vegas Unwrapped. As always, gentlemen, be kind to each other. And why is that?
Because
we're all we got.
Thank God, that's all we got. We'll be back next week, same time, same bat channel. Stay tuned for BCN Talk with Robert and Gil following Vegas Unwrapped.
Okay.